Good evening, everyone. My name is Jacqueline Côté. I'm the Director of Public Relations here at the Institute. And I'm really happy to see you in such large numbers. I know the auditorium is very big, but we dreamt this idea about 3 days ago, and here we are, 100 people in the room. And I have to thank Antoine Marguier, who is the director, conductor, founder of the United Nations Orchestra, for having suggested that Mr. Won come to us. So it's my great pleasure to introduce you, and I am sure I'm going to say your name wrongly, Hyung Joon Won, who is a violinist from Korea of international renown. He has won many prizes and he has been playing as soloist in many international orchestra around the world. But he's not only a violinist, he's also an activist. And I guess it's with the activist hat that my attention got caught. Not because we don't like music, but we're an academic institution on the topics that you all know we work on. And as an activist, he's been working unrelentlessly on this idea of reconciliation, of reunification of the two Koreas. And he has chosen his art, his music, as a tool for passing on his message. So he's been traveling now for I don't know how many days nonstop, but he agreed to do a concert for us, 10, 15 minutes, something like this. I'll leave this to your discretion. And then I will introduce Dr. Venman, who is the director, well, he's a researcher at the Graduate Institute. He's also the director of the Geneva Peace Building Platform. And he's been working on these issues, and he's very interested to hear what Mr. Won can contribute to the matter. After a short discussion, we will then, as we always do, open the floor for questions, and I would think by 7:30 you should all be going home to have your dinner. So thank you very much, and thank you, Mr. Won, for being with us. It's all yours now.
Thank you. Recital.
Thank you.
for this demonstration that harmony in the Korea is possible. And if we are asking us now whether harmony in Korea is possible, we shall find all the answers now as we discuss. Thank you very much. Why don't we take a seat? Well, your presence here today comes at a very opportune moment in general for discussions on peace and music in Geneva. Because many of you will know that there is a fairly large infrastructure project which is in preparation on the Place des Nations, the Cité de la Musique, which will be one of Europe's largest symphonic orchestra houses. Which will be built over the next three to five years, I think. So having such an orchestra house on the center of Place des Nations will, of course, create a new symbol and also a lot more discussions on music and peace in this town, not just the peace negotiations in the Palais des Nations or the research generated in the Gradit Institute and other actors in the Geneva community, but also with music and new musicians coming here. Because I think what you have already shown, music touches at a much different level every human being, wherever they are divided across communities. But I think for us to learn more about your work, why don't you tell us a little bit more? I think you prepared a little presentation. And just walk us through about your work on music and peace. And then I have a few other questions up my sleeve.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me. I'm very honored to be here. Mr. Kim and also Leah Suter, I think she's here, and also Antwing, maestro from UN Orchestra. Before I start, I really would like to just play one more piece. It's a very short piece, but it's from Korea. And then, you know, please let me start with my project. Thank you. This piece is called Spring in my hometown and probably the most popular children's song in South Korea. And the song is also well known across many generations because it has a particular historical significance in Korea. It was made during the time of Japanese colonization of the Korean Peninsula. Just a little bit about the history. After World War II and the following liberation from Japan, Korea was separated into two countries in 1945. And then the Korean War, a decade later. And when it ended in a ceasefire, marked the separation called DMZ. It's a demilitarized zone. And 72 years later, in this year of 2017, North Korea and South Korea still remain separated by the DMZ. Just a little bit about my background. My grandfather, actually, he came from North Korea during the Korean War. And his mother had stayed behind. And they never met again in his lifetime. But my grandfather, he never forgot her. And I remember he kept a pair of her shoes in his drawer. And unfortunately, they are only 20 times of the separated family meetings were held since the Korean War. And it is because we had a war against each other and so many families were killed, and this hostility still remained today. And there were some positive results after the summit meetings of the two Korean leaders of Korea, but they did not last due to political situations. So, like many South Koreans, and based on my understanding of my grandfather's painful separation and of many other people in South Korea, I decided to seek opportunities to meet North Korean with the skill I had, so which was music. And this is why I have been promoting this musical concerts between North and South since 2009. And so I wanted to meet and I wanted to visit my grandmother's tomb in North Korea, but technically I'm not allowed to go there. So this has been tremendously my efforts, actually, I started to meet the people together through music. Just little experience from my high school, maybe, you know, that how I started this project with my belief. I was taking advanced placement chemistry class when I was in high school. And I asked my chemistry teacher one day that, teacher, is it possible all the chemical elements in the periodic table can bond together, make a one single product? And he said, Hyung Joon, you will go to the Juilliard School, so why are you in this class? So he was... And yeah, it was a silly question, and the answer is negative. But but later, I found out that the orchestras are all musical versions of the periodic table. It comprises of the sounds of many different instruments that come together to make one harmony. So the goal is to make established peace in the Korean Peninsula, so people from both countries travel and meet together until unification. But I'm trying to demonstrate this screen in front of you because I'm trying to say, what is peace? Without peace, North and South Korean, we are not able to meet together. Because both governments have to agree for each other to let people meet and talk. We have regulations and laws. Without that, it's impossible to meet together. And so for my side, I had to figure out what peace is. And from a musical perspective, peace is harmony. If you look at the dictionary, it's called a state of being in agreement or concord. So I would say peace is harmony or harmony is peace. Then, from my experience of playing violin and in the orchestra, I have to give you how it works in orchestra, how they play in harmony. Because in musical world, we are making harmony. Peace is already there in orchestra. For example, at any concert hall performance, you'd see the following three steps. First, the concertmaster stands up. And then second, the oboist plays a standard pitch of A which is 440 hertz equals 440 vibrations per second. Third, everyone else in the orchestra tunes to the A. Those three steps are essential for the entire orchestra. But without listening, this harmony is impossible. We actually, I think maybe some of you already recognized that before I started my playing the violin, I was tuning the strings, because we have four strings of the violin are ascending in fifth on G, D, A, E, and four of them must be in harmony before you do anything else. Otherwise, no matter how beautifully or emotionally you play, you will only discord and the bad performance would be left. So before tuning, we have to listen to the sounds. For myself, I have to listen to the A very carefully when I tune, just like everyone else in the orchestra. And I also need to listen as I play to make sure that I keep the rhythm and the dynamics as everyone else in the orchestra. And this process is very essential to harmony. So I thought of maybe I can, I believe I can apply this same process of listening and tuning to the Korean Peninsula, which is so complicated in this chord. And I thought maybe we should approach it in a new way, which we've never attempted before. And one of the ways, can you please, yes, one more please. One of the ways in establishing peace is to make a concert at the joint security area at Panmunjom, where the armistice agreement was signed, and still the Korean, North Korean and South Korean forces stand face to face. It's a highly militarized zone, and the civilians are now allowed to enter without permission from the United Nations command. And 2015, I think Maestro Antoine, he can remember this scene. After many years of attempting to convince two Korean governments, including the United Nations command, the choirs from North and the orchestras from South, we were planned to meet across the borderline at Panmunjom on the 70th anniversary of the Liberation Day. However, we are not able to cross the bridge to get Panmunjom, because a week ago from the event, there was a landmine explosion in DMZ, and my government had to cancel the concert. So we were waiting on the bridge before the gate, and after 2 hours later, the soldiers from the military, they came up our bus. They said the concert was canceled. But later, we found out the North Korean, they came to the borderline. And unfortunately, we were not able to be there. Well, that was the actually plan, to meet across the borderline. So imagine if we are standing across the borderline and you're not supposed to talk, meet, and touch. The music is the only ultimate medium of understanding through which people are forced to listen to each other, regardless of nationality and the backgrounds. So I think it is not a dream anymore that I want to see musicians from North and South Korea come together and listen to their sounds in, you know, sharing the experience of one orchestra. Yeah, I mean, I'm not trying to say if we make a joint concert in one orchestra, we'll bring peace. I'm not talking about that. Of course, if we make it we don't know peace will come. I mean, we don't know about that. I'm not trying to say that if we accomplish that, we'll make a peace. I'm trying to say, since I'm a musician, violinist, I already told you a demonstration from musical world, how orchestras with different sounds, with different instruments, we are able to communicate each other in unison and making harmony. That is because we listen to another. We listen to each other. So listening is a very important process and step of dialogue, communicate, to commune to each other. And yeah, I mean, for example, this is my last conclusion. What if I give you some examples, topics, for example, lunch to all of you here. What are we going to have at dinner? Of course, we'll have different answers. How about love? You know, we'll have different answers with different perspectives about in regarding love. But if I give you instruments with some music to you, then we are in harmony. It is because naturally we know for ourselves that we have to listen to each other to make harmony. So I think as being a musician, I really want to convey this message, the value of music, how we comprise and how we communicate each other by listening to each other. And I really want to say this to the people, and including our countries, our government, and United Nations, for the world, to make a better world. Thank you.
Connects very well of this philosophy and the spirit of music and peace to a city like International Geneva is that Geneva is very much the capital of human security, the individual as the object of security. And therefore here a music and peace has a wonderful space, in fact, to unfold, because what you mentioned with respect to touching individuals' feelings, having a different type of language, listening, is also at the very heart of how a big community in this town that is involved in peace mediation and peace processes goes about wanting to resolve conflicts, more through speaking, not yet so much through music, but I think they have a new tool in their repertoire. Now, as we go on, let me perhaps just ask two types of questions to get understand you a little bit more from a personal point of view. How did you get into music? How did you discover the violin as your instrument? And when did you really realize that with this tool, you would like to make peace, contribute to reconciliation, and ultimately to harmony?
Well, at the beginning, I already told you I'm from separate family, and I had my grandfather's history, that his longing to his mother for North Korea. So I've been raising to see that experience in my family. And I started my violin, it was very accidentally, I had some curiosity how this wood makes sounds. So I was at 7 years old and asked my parents to buy this instrument. And that's how I started, accidentally. And then, it could be a terrible moment or experience that I had to go to the army service. I mean, every Korean citizen man, you know, we have to do army service for 2 years. And I really was afraid of going there, but I had to go there. So when I was in army, of course, I cannot, you know, practice or do anything, you know, except just exercise, military exercise. But after a year, I got injured on my right shoulder, that I had a big surgery. So that was the reason I left the army without finishing it. And after the rehabilitation, I almost gave up playing the violin. And then I found out maybe I should do something related to music. And that was the orchestra festival I found in Japan. It's called the Pacific Music Festival by Leonard Bernstein. And so I wanted to do that festival in my country. So that's how we started, called the Lindenbaum Music Festival in 2009. And then after the first festival, I got to know Daniel Barenboim. He already established a divan orchestra between Palestine and Israel, and that orchestra was touring throughout the world. So I got kind of inspiration from him with my family background and through music. This maestro, world famous maestro, is doing something great, in the Middle East, where the bombs are killing people. So with my festival, I thought maybe we should invite North Korean and South Korean young musicians together in one orchestra. That's how I started this project back to 2009.
Excellent. And before we give the floor to the audience, just one final question. Is there any specific kind of marking experience that really confirmed your spirit that I really have to do this now or never? Is there any specific moment or like a trigger that made you do this?
See, I already told you about how it works. In musically, we are making peace, we are making harmony in orchestra. This is a very simple concept and simple idea. I mean, everyone knows that. I mean, this is so obvious. I mean, every musician, for example, even, you know, 5 or 6 years old kids, when they start practice the violin or cello, anything, any instruments, the first step is they tune. So it happens everywhere. Of course, I know this. But with my family experience and Daniel Barenboim inspiration, just started this big project together, North and South Korean, in one orchestra. And after years, you know, by convincing the government, it was such a terrible times, I was keep continuing doing this. And people asked me, I even including my family, why are you doing these crazy things? You know, we are having war, and you know, I mean, okay, let's say you make a joint concert and North Korean, you know, they're not going to give up nuclear bomb. You know, I mean, why are you doing this crazy thing? I mean, that I got these questions so many times, and even journalists or professors or ordinary people, even when I give lectures at universities, when I tell this story, people ask me, why are you doing this project? And of course, the first few times I said, oh, because Barenboim is doing this, I'm doing this. Because this definitely will bring peace if we make this. That was my answers at the beginning. And then after I, you know, got this, you know, questions, same, you know, questions. And I start to ask for myself, seriously, the project I'm doing, I'm promoting with my effort, is it really important? I mean, do I have a belief that I have to continue this work project and I should not give up? And then I start to analyze for myself related to music. And then it came to the just beginning of how I started the violin. Like, oh yes, we have 4 different strings on violin, but they must be tuned before I start playing the violin. And if I look at the orchestra, I say, oh yes, we listen and we tune before we play. And that's the value of music, which keeps musicians and the sounds in making harmony. And this very simple and obvious idea and concept because of the project I've been, mm-hmm. you know, promoting, that made me realize, oh my God, the violin, what I'm doing is very, very important to make the project and peace or harmony for the world. And I think it can apply to everyone else, you know, scientists or engineering. We do our works for living, but when we think about why we are doing our majors, and then I think we definitely will find some solutions or philosophical the efforts for living and as human beings.
I must say, whenever people tell me or other friends that they're crazy, for me it's an indicator that it's the right direction. because you expand the expectation and the vision of others where they think you can't reach. And if we don't keep on doing the crazy things or what other people think crazy, we'll never get to that harmony. And I applaud you for that. We have, of course, time for question, comments, or observations from the floor. We have also a microphone in the back. I think that I see two hands up there, one, the lady there, and then we come towards the front.
Thank you so much.
Please introduce yourself briefly as you raise your question.
Sure. My name is Geneva Damayanti, and I'm an East Asia International Relations student. And I would like to ask, I'm interested to know what organization or departments in both of the countries that you work with, and also what were their responses when you first brought the idea? So I wanted to know the dynamic between the organizations that you work with.
Okay. My organization is called the Lindenbaum Festival Orchestra, and I'm a founder of that orchestra. And of course, the Antoine Maguire Maestro from UN Orchestra, he came to South Korea when we attempted this joint orchestra concert at Panmunjom in 2015. And for the North, when we tried to reach to convey the message, the plan, because I'm a South Korean citizen, I must get official permission from my government to contact to the North. So my channel was the North Korean mission at UN in New York City. So after getting the permission from my government and then sending the message to the mission, the North Korean mission at UN, and then they send to the Pyongyang, where the government in North Korea. And then after reviewing, they sent back to the answer whether they're accepting or not my project. That is really hard step. I mean, to do something, to contact or to meet. It's everything is regulated and permitted by both governments. So Even to find these steps, it took probably 3 years. I mean, majority of people in South Korea, we are not really trying this because we are educated not to contact with North Korean because we think North Korean is dangerous. Although we live same peninsula, we are not allowed to travel. The communication is blocked. Even though I had the idea, okay, so this is a great idea, so I need to contact musical conservatory or orchestra in Pyongyang, North Korea. But, you know, without experience, without, knowing them, how can I keep in touch with them? So to find out the right way to do, send a message in legitimate way, that took a lot of time. And I was very lucky that they accepted, I mean, both governments. But this hasn't been happened because always, every year since 2011, something happened. Like, you know, back to 2011, the DMZ, the explosion. And if something happens that this concert is, it's very hard to promote, yeah.
Another question right here. Yes, and then we come slowly to the front.
Arthur Clay on the Korean side. I'm a professor for art and technology at Seogang University in Seoul. On the Swiss side, I live in Basel and create events between borders such as Asia and Switzerland. And my question is, do you feel that we could maybe move the DMZ to Switzerland, where more fertile ground between the orchestras could take place?
No, thank you very much, Professor Clay. That's why I'm here. We always need third party. We always need third country or third party. It's like music is already third. To connect both countries. Because after 8 years of attempting this little thing, singing together to do, you know, in orchestra, it's, you know, this is really, you know, I would say ridiculous. We are not allowed to sing together. That's the reality in Korea. And I tried to do that in Korean Peninsula since 2009. And this is already after 8 years. And I guess maybe the Switzerland, the neutral nation, could be the best venue for hosting the musicians from both countries. Maybe that would be the faster and maybe fair to both countries to do something together.
Excellent. There was another question here, and then we're going to come to you.
Yes. My name is George Papadatos. I'm the head of mission and permanent observer of an international organization called European Public Law Organization. I shall try to expand a little more in your terms on the link between music and politics. You mentioned Daniel Barenboim. Apart from his contribution to the peace process, his orchestra members, his musicians, call him Danny, which was unheard of in the times of Furtwängler or Bruno Walter. So what I'm saying is I want to focus on the role of the orchestra director, of the maestro, and in bringing about harmony in his own group. If we expand this, then we have a country that's divided into two. And my question is, do the people listen to their orchestra directors, because these are the heads of state, the people who run the country, Kim Jong-un, and now you're going to have elections pretty soon. And I would like to get a feeling of what do the people really feel, what is your feeling, regardless from what the politicians are saying or the press, which I honestly have been following this situation for a long time, and I'm very confused as to what messages we get right now internationally. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, that is really difficult question, but I want to say like this. I mean, this is Easter season, right? The Jesus Christ. I don't want to say about the religion and stuff, but you know, we know Jesus came like 1,000 years ago, and his contribution to the world, you know, salvation and whatever. Well, some people believe and some people, they do not believe, but, you know, people who believe and they think, you know, that's the right thing to do, the right thing to believe. And still, but some people, they don't believe. That's the reality. I mean, so back to your question. I mean, it is true that the decision makers are politicians. And I'm not a politician. Well, so when I started this project with the idea, no one was listening because I was nothing. I was not Daniel Barenboim. You know, because he is famous, he's already a big conductor. So with his philosophy, with his mission, maybe he has a better position to do something. Even Divan Orchestra by Daniel Barenboim, it's much easier. I mean, honestly, because the Palestine and Israel government, at least, they do not prohibit, you know, they do not ban their young musician to do something together. Unlike our countries, I said our countries, if we do something together, then the both governments must agree for each other. So, of course, they're the politicians who make decisions, and they're the politicians that I would try hard to convince. And I think I have been doing this whenever I play, whenever I give a concert. I always say the value of music and how it works in orchestra, why musicians are able to communicate better. So it's a simple concept I'm trying to convey. That's all I'm doing. And it's pity that most politicians in both country, our country, they do not listen. But I'm sure, you know, I'm very honored to be here. And I was doing another lecture in Germany and Paris. And I will do as many as I can until, you know, people believe. But yeah, please consider my position that I haven't give up, right, for almost 10 years. And it is because I have a belief, strong belief in my mind and in my heart that as a musician and as being a musician, we are making peace. And I want to demonstrate this very clearly just by giving you instruments, as I just previously said. If anyone plays instruments here, anyone? Yes. Well, yeah. So you know how this process going on, right? When you play together. Yeah, we know our ultimate goal is to make harmony. It's by listening.
You spoke a lot about conductor and the role of conductors. And so I think we should also give the conductors a moment to reflect on this, because we have Maestro Antoine, of course, in the room. And you have also been working a lot in the realm of peace and music. If you could share the microphone with our maestro, please.
Hello. I'm very happy to be here, and that our friend Hyung Joon is here too. Thank you very much for inviting him. Well, this discussion reminds me a lot of wonderful memories that about the adventure we had 2 years ago in Seoul and the DMZ. What I remember is the first time I saw this man, the first discussion we had, I actually thought he was crazy. And I agree with you. I like these people because, as you said, they are the one who build and who go further. So I immediately followed him and understood the point. So for me, the picture was to create a very small window, not a door, but just a window on this so strong and militarized DMZ. So I said, if I can do that, it would be fantastic. We couldn't, but I'm sure we will, or you will, because I can assure you this guy will never give up. I know him very well. About the conductor, it is true, and this discussion made me understand even more that music and the tuning actually is extremely powerful in between the people, the human beings, at least the musicians. And as a conductor, you can feel that. You can feel when you really reach the harmony. So, yeah, I'm completely convinced that this is a great way to start a process here with music, with orchestra, with making people play together. And we have been thinking already about a project that could happen in Geneva with musicians from the north and the south. So we think about that. We almost work on that. It's about the tuning. It's also about the heart, the heart of the people, you know, because when you tune, then the heart play and understand the same thing together. And this is also something you can feel as a conductor. And about Korea, recently we, with United Nations Orchestra, we played for Ban Ki-moon. He came in Geneva for a farewell concert that we gave for him. And thanks to you, I knew this piece called Arirang, which is a Korean piece, which could be the national anthem, but it's not. And it's coming from the North Korea. And I know that a lot of people told me that Mr. Ban Ki-moon was extremely touched to hear this music written from a North Korean composer in Geneva. And well, that's a question of heart as well, you know, so his heart was moved. And I'm sure that the music that we can produce all together is extremely powerful. Extremely. It's a real tool to make it happen.
Excellent. Thank you very much. These are wonderful closing words, of course, as we're coming surely but calmly to and in harmony to our end of this meeting. I just want to say two things. First, I think there are, in my research and in my experience, I have never seen any conflict that did not end. And also, the Korean situation will end at one point. And we, across all different professional spectrums, we have to be ready at the moment when you need to reestablish a linkage between these hearts that have been divided. My conviction why this is the case is because I've seen it myself. I'm German, and I have seen two divided parts that have grown together. Somehow, has it been a perfect growing together? No. But people have been connected, and a lot of that connectedness has happened through music and other types of activities. And the second thing I want to say is that it really needs people who expound the boundaries. And very often, these are not the politicians. Every person, every human being, every professional has a role to play to build peace. And artists, musicians, and those who perhaps do not have the word peace in their job description, they play a very important role to build peace. And I think we are all here in Geneva to help those who want to build peace so that in Korea and in many other places of the world, we can make that step forward to connect individuals and connect to that what is ultimately that one humanity and that we are all striving to put into harmony. So thank you very much for your concert, for your words, and for all of you for being here. And I'm sure we can linger around a little bit more to exchange informally. Thank you very much.
Thank you.